Hello everybody, Ryan here with a foundations level GRE / GMAT problem. Take a couple minutes, give it a try, and we'll figure out how to do it together. Okay, let us talk about it. So, there are a couple of ways you can do a problem like this. One thing, always on the menu, never the most tempting option on the menu, is algebra. Anytime you see the word average in a problem, you can get away with using the average formula. Now, there are going to be problems in which it becomes impractical to do so, but this isn't one of them. This one is made for the average formula. What is the average formula? Let's remind ourselves. The average is equal to the sum, which is, of course, the total you get when you add up everything, over the number of terms. Three-part formula. All we have to do is basically fill in the blanks, and we'll be able to calculate the average. So, where does the sum come from? Well, we know we want to find the average of x, x minus 6, and x plus 12. It looks like five things, but in reality, it's three. X minus 6 gets treated as a single term, as does x plus 12, and they all go on top of this formula to give us the sum. So the average is going to be x plus x minus 6. The parentheses are totally unnecessary. I like to put them there just to remind myself that that thing's being treated as a single term. And of course, last, but definitely not least, x plus 12. Now, what about the number of terms? Well, that's why it's important to note that even though there are five things up there, there are indeed only three terms, because that is a potential mistake waiting to happen, and we just avoided it. We're awesome. What do we have to do? Combine like terms. That's what algebra's always been about. Get those x's together. They don't like to be apart. We got three of them up there, and get those numbers together as well. We've got a minus 6, we got a plus 12. Now that's going to end up on the positive side, because the positive number is so much bigger than the negative number. It's going to end up a plus 6. And all of that is going to be over 3. Should we manage to successfully do this, we're going to get our average. I promise. How do we do it from here, though? We've got this complication in which we've got a couple of terms on top of a fraction. We got this thing on the bottom of a fraction. There are no fractions in the answer choices, so something's got to happen with that 3 on the bottom. Well, this is where factoring comes into play. Noticing that we've got a 3 in our first term up top, and a secret 3 in our second term, we factor it out. Pull a 3 out and you'll be left with an x and a 2 inside, whatever it would take to multiply back to a 3x plus 6, essentially. Put that all over 3, and now, through the magic of algebra, the 3s disappear as though they were never even there to begin with. Let's never talk about them again. We're left with the answer. The average is x plus 2. Now, for those of you who are like, but there's got to be a better way. I don't want to do algebra. I don't like adding up x's. Don't know what's going to happen there. Well, there is indeed. One of the patterns this problem falls into is that there are variables in the answer choices. And in almost every case, when you see variables in the answer choices, you can just make up a number. You can make up whatever number you want. You probably don't want to make up 1,500 or something like that, because that's going to make your life difficult. But make up a simple number for x, and you'll be okay. You probably want to avoid 0, you probably want to avoid 1. That's going to lead to bad things in some of the answer choices. Other than that, good to go. Let's say we pick 2 for x. Now, what happens then? We basically play through the whole problem the exact same way, using the average formula and everything, but instead of x, we're just calling it 2, and we're treating it like 2. So what does that mean? It means our average now is going to be 2, and then 2 minus 6 here for our second term, a negative 4, and finally 2 plus 12 for our third term here, a 14. All of that's still going to be divided by 3, because of course we still have 3 terms up there. But now we don't have to worry about x's, we don't even have to worry about factoring. We've just got numbers there. 2 and a minus 4 will make a negative 2, and that plus 14 will make a positive 12. And 12 over 3, that's something we can do without factoring. That is going to be 4. Now, here's the rub. There's no 4 among the answer choices. So what we're going to have to do as our last step is come back over to those answer choices, plug in the same number we chose for x, 2, and see which one spits back out a 4. A is going to give us a 2. That won't do the trick. But B, of course, gives us our 4. C gives us something other than 4. D gives us something other than 4. We don't even necessarily need to go to all the trouble of plugging in our x's. We just need to make sure that we're not getting another answer that in some sneaky way gives us a 4 as well. Because in that case, we'd have to try with one more number and see which one stands true. Thank you for watching. I hope that was helpful. Subscribe for more GRE Math Spotlight videos from Manhattan Prep. And leave us a comment letting us know how you solved it. Happy studying.